Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Students,
to the wall! To the wall!
I'm Sherry Blevins of New River Valley Driving School. On behalf of the youth of Virginia Speak Out About Traffic, Yugasoke, we are proud to present Shattered Dreams. Shattered Dreams is a mock crash to bring the awareness of teen accidents and fatalities. The show will show the aftermath of the deadly consequences of making poor driving decisions. Although this is a drama, only in a reenactment, it is accurate and realistic to a true traffic crash. Distractions kill. Bad decisions have fatal consequences. With the upcoming prom and graduation season, it is a fine time to remind students to drive safe. Spring and summer can be the dangerous time for teen drivers. More late nights, enjoying the streets of the highway with friends of online circuit to risky driving behavior. Shattered Dreams is a collaborative effort. We would like to thank Deputy Jason West, Yugasoke advisor, Auburn Yugasoke club members, our special administrator, Neil Turner, emergency service coordinator for Montgomery County, the Reiner Rescue Department, the Reiner Fire Department, Carillion Life Farm, the Montgomery Sheriff's Department, the Virginia State Police, Foreign Funeral Service, and special guests, Lieutenant Mark Hollingsworth, Darlene Rosenbaum, Jerry Saul, and all of the volunteers that work every day hard to save lives. It is our hope that you will buckle up, slow down, and drive safe. The scene, Ian and his friends, Kimberly, Katie, Sarah, and Taylor, are traveling at a high rate of speed. There are lots of distractions in the car. The music is loud, cell phone is ringing, some are not wearing their seatbelts. They seem to be having a good time. Sarah is not even supposed to be in the car. She's lied to her family and is supposed to be at a sleepover. Ian is distracted, veers off the lane, and crashes into a family, a mother and a son, who are entrapped. Now, we present Shattered Dreams.
This is awful. This is like my mom's favorite song in the 80s.
Guys.
It's Dylan's song. Girls just wanna have fun.
Shut up.
Whatever. Girls just
guys,
wanna
shut
have
up.
Fun.
I'm gonna drink it. Help me find it.
Answer it.
Camera's
up.
Oh, I
like
it.
No, give that to me.
Oh,
yeah.
At least.
No, give that to me. Give that to me.
Oh, no.
No,
answer.
No, no, no.
Montgomery County 911, what is your emergency? I need to report an accident. Where? It's near the Reiner and Miss Vet Clinic. The Ohio Road is there. Yes, right in the hurricane. What's wrong? We've got a head-on collision, it looks like.
Okay, can you tell if anybody's injured?
It looks like somebody's laying on the hood of the car.
Can you tell if they're alive?
They're not moving.
Is anybody else laying outside the vehicle, you can tell?
I don't see anybody else laying outside the vehicle.
Is the road blocked?
Just the southbound lane at the moment.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and dispatch fire and rescue. Stay on the line with me just a minute. I'll get some more information from you.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
1087, repeat 1087. Reference to an accident, head on collision. Intersection of Rhino Road and Dairy Road, repeat. Reference to an accident, head on collision. Rhino Road and Dairy Road. Montgomery County clear, 1321.
You'll notice as the state police arrive on the scene, the fire and rescue are responding and begin to do an assessment of the patients. As you can see, the two cars have crashed head-on. There's injuries inside the vehicles, both vehicles, and one individual has been ejected from the car. Assistant Fire Chief Jerry Saul here with me. What are they doing right now, Chief? I see them pulling hose out of the back of the truck. Okay, when you said that they're cribbing, what does that mean?
Okay, cribbing is something that we use, this little technology, the wooden blocks up underneath the cars and the little stair step items there, and the little blue and red stabilizer on the red car, that's just to keep us from moving while they work on the patients in the car.
So safety is important to your men as well as it is for the victims of the crash. We've got the first lieutenant of the rescue squad, Darlene Rosenbaum, is here. Darlene, what are your people doing as they're coming to the car?
They're loading the backboard and the jump bag, which are used for patient assessment. They're assessing the worst injuries now, and those will be the ones that are treated and transported first.
Okay, and in a jump bag, what kind of equipment is in that bag?
In that bag, you have oxygen, you have your stethoscope, and your blood pressure cuff. You have a pulse ox, which measures the amount of blood flow that the patient's getting. And right now, as you can see, they're taking a pulse of
these patients. Okay, and how will you determine which patient goes to the hospital first?
It would be a patient with the most life-threatening injuries that will be transported first.
Okay, and I heard somebody say something about lifeguards. Wait a minute, what are they doing at the front of the red car now?
We have a patient that was dead on the scene, and they are covering that patient up right now. We cover them up so no one else has to really see them, and they are going to wait to transport them.
Okay, and will that patient be transported by the rescue squad, or will they be transported by the fire department?
That patient will be transported by the funeral home.
Now, it looks like we've got about, what, six or seven patients there?
It looks like we have four patients in the black car, and we're looking at two patients in the red car at this time.
Okay, with so many patients, how do you determine who you go to first?
Well, like I said, we're going to look for blood, we're going to look for life-threatening injuries. It looks like in the red car, we're going to have some life-threatening injury. Right now, in the black car, we have a broken arm, and as you can see, they are splinting that arm and getting ready to remove her. And in our red car, we have entrapment.
And what do you mean by entrapment? Does that mean that he's done something inside the car, or the car surrounded him, or what does that mean?
Entrapment means that the patient cannot be removed without cutting the car apart, and we have our firemen who are right now extricating that patient from the car.
Okay, if the patients know each other, will they automatically go to the same hospital?
No, we want to usually separate our patients so we don't send too many life-threatening injuries to one hospital and overload that hospital.
Okay, and I just saw the helicopter up above. Who are they coming to get? What's the reason that you would call the helicopter here?
If we have a serious life-threatening injury, as we do in the red car, we have an open femur fracture, which is the largest bone in the body and the largest muscle, and that is a life-threatening injury due to blood loss.
Okay, I see a lot of volunteers here. How many members are there on the rescue squad?
There's approximately 21 members on Runner Rescue at this time.
If I wanted to be a member, how would I go about doing that?
You can stop by our station or talk to one of our members, and we'll be happy to get you an application, and your application will just go through the approval process.
Okay, and if I was a high school junior or senior, could I become a member of the rescue squad? Junior or senior in high school, could I be a junior member of the rescue squad?
As long as you are 16 years old and with your parents' permission, yes, you can.
Okay, and now as lifeguard has already landed and we see the people getting out of the helicopter, what is their job now?
As soon as we get our gentleman extricated out of his car, patient care will be turned from Runner Rescue to the lifeguard crew.
Okay, and are these doctors or who are they with lifeguards?
On lifeguards, you have a pilot and you have a nurse
as well as a paramedic.
Okay, Chief Saul, what are they doing right now with all your firemen there? I don't understand what's going on.
Okay, Neil, they're trying to get the vehicle open so they can get the patient that they're going to fly out on a lifeguard. Lifeguard's just down the road from here, probably 6 minutes out to New River Valley Medical Center. This is Lifeguard 11. They can be here in a matter of a few minutes. We have the one red fire truck at the other end of the field. That's policy that we stand by for them anytime they land due to the fuel that's on the helicopter. And right now the guys are just working with the patient, getting ready to be transported. You'll notice one of the paramedics will probably come over and help with the rescue squad.
Okay, and the girl that was on the hood of the car is being removed. Is the funeral home here, or what are they doing?
They've probably been notified from the state police. They advise them to come in. The medical examiner will come in, and if the patient is deceased, they'll pronounce them deceased, and then that can be transported to the local funeral home.
Okay, and Darlene, I see that some of the victims have been taken out of the black car, and they're being put on a stretcher. What's the straps? What are those for?
These are called fire straps, and they're put on the patient to secure them to the backboard so they don't move. We also have put a C-collar on that patient to stabilize their neck, because we don't want them moving their neck at all.
That's pretty interesting. A lot of work being done right now, and I see the flight crew coming over. I want to talk with a member of the flight crew now and just ask Laura Whitlow with the Lifeguard 11. Tell me a little bit about what you all are doing and what will your people do as I see the flight crew approaching the patient. Will they actually help in the patient care or patient assessment?
Absolutely. That's our job at QMS crew. Get there, secure your team. And they'll start working on the patient when we get to them. Hopefully, they'll be able to get us a report, tell us their findings, what the patient needs, if the person is having a hard time with their airway or maintaining their own airway, we can help them with that. Cure their airway, either with some ET tubes to help them breathe. That's something we do. We can help them get the patient ready. This is kind of what the crew's doing down there. They're fire strapping them, getting them secured to the board, and then we'll take them and load them in the aircraft, and our goal is to get them to the hospital as quickly as possible.
Okay, now, would your crew help determine which is the most severe patient that needs to go the quickest?
Absolutely, yes, sir. Usually we will definitely rely on the EMS crews there to give us their feedback regarding who they feel is the most urgent, and then we'll kind of triage in there at the scene, take a look, airway taking the most precedence over anything.
Now, I know that like the rescue squad has EMTs and advanced level. I know that there's a nurse on the helicopter and maybe a paramedic. They can do much more on the scene than the rescue squad can also, right?
That's true. We have a nurse, an RN, a paramedic, and a pilot. That's our crew. We find this works the best for us since we do scene transports and also interfacility transports with ICU patients. Kind of have that nurse portion of the hospital and then the paramedic portion with the scene. The medics in the field do a great job and they do what our medics do, but then we can also, again, if we have a patient who has a head injury or is questionable with their airway, we can give them medications to put them to sleep and then go ahead and put an ET tube down and find that way. We also have some medications that the crews don't have.
So your care is even at a more advanced level.
Yes.
Than the rescue squad. Now, let's say from right here on the football field to Roanoke Memorial, about how long is that trip?
We're looking at about 16 minutes.
And that's loading, getting there, unloading?
Loading, getting there, unloading. Our purpose is to cut time, especially in a trauma like this, where blood volume and that kind of thing, loss is a huge issue. The quicker we can get you to Roanoke Memorial, the better off.
Okay, and I know that Lifeguard has just expanded, and now you have 10, 11, and 12. That must be pretty exciting for the Lifeguard team.
It's been very exciting for us. So now we have moved our Lifeguard 10 base from Roanoke out to the Westlake area, to the Lake area. Helped through that kind of Martinsville, Greenville down in that area population. Then we'll stay right here in New River, and then Lifeguard 12 will be out in Lexington. The goal being that we can stay out on the periphery of the hospital and can bring people to Memorial from those more rural areas.
Or maybe tell the folks here, why is early intervention so important to the patient? Why would we even consider putting somebody on a helicopter, sending them to Roanoke when we've got a hospital just 5 or 6 miles away?
There's two reasons. If you have a patient, perfect example, in a trauma, who have broken limbs or possibly internal injuries where they're bleeding, it's a matter of time to get to the OR, get into that source of bleeding and stop it, volume loss, fluid loss. And then in Roanoke Memorial, it's a level one trauma center. So in a severe trauma, you're gonna have more care, physicians that are trained in that area, anesthesia, different areas that are gonna help you get that best patient outcome. It's a lot better to go straight to Roanoke Memorial than go to New River and then have to keep transferred.
So if, like our patient here in the red car, let's say that he needed surgery, he could probably be in surgery with a full crew and having that surgery done within maybe an hour?
Definitely, that would be the goal. That golden hour in a trauma, we want to get there to the hospital and get care within 60 minutes. So getting them there, and once we're there, if it's called a trauma in Roanoke Memorial, all of those people will be there waiting for that patient as soon as they arrive. Everyone will be assembled in the trauma bay to be able to move and expedite the patient care.
So it's like a mega emergency where we go in and maybe get stitches in our hand. They're going to go in and get surgery and other more advanced care.
That's exactly right. If you go into that trauma bay, you're going to have a team assembled of everyone you need to know to take care for any part of the body that's injured.
Now, is there a possibility, like today we say that we have one traumatic injury, is there a possibility that you could fly two people?
Yes, sir. All of our aircraft are equipped to fly two patients. We have a second stretcher in there. The only criteria we kind of have as a crew is to triage and make sure that we feel comfortable that we can handle both people. If we have someone who is requiring both of our care, then what we will do is go ahead and dispatch multiple helicopters to that scene. So if we're here in 5 minutes, Lifeguard 12 could be here in 15 or 20, or so could Lifeguard 10. So we'll go ahead and dispatch that other aircraft, get here, help secure the situation, take the most urgent, and then they'll be here to back up for the rest of the patients.
That's great.
It is great.
How do you make a determination of, okay, I'm going to take this patient to Roanoke Memorial, but what if the individual had a different kind of injuries, burns or something of that nature, maybe going to another hospital?
That's exactly right. There are certain injuries where we know we're going to have to go to a burn center. Burns are number one. Used to be spinal cord injuries too, but they can handle those now at Roanoke Memorial. So typically we'll take a look at NC Baptist, which for this area is probably the closest, or UVA. So we do transport burns to UVA or Baptist. Sometimes some eye injuries also will take to UVA.
Now, Darlene, let me ask you, it looks like it's taken a long time to get this patient ready to go. Is that just me, or is it really taking a long time?
It does take a while to load a patient. Right here in the red car, you can see they put the traction splint on that femur fracture, and that can take a few extra minutes, but it's definitely worth it because you are reducing pain and possible more injuries from rubbing of the bone and tearing into the rest of the muscle.
Okay, why is it so important to take extra time to get them all packaged? Why can't you just throw them up on that stretcher and get them in the helicopter? They can be there quick.
Well, we want the patient to be stabilized so they don't cause further injuries to themselves, and so the crew can work on them and they aren't flopping all around in the helicopter.
Now, Laura, I know your folks have helped them in assessing this patient and making that determination. there's a huge stretcher that's going out there on wheels. Will they put that whole thing in the helicopter?
No, sir. They will take that patient on a backboard. And for us, the quickest way to load a patient on a backboard is to slide it onto our stretcher that's already in the aircraft. However, if we needed to, we could take our stretcher out the back doors of the aircraft, those are called the clamshell doors in the back, open like a clamshell, and roll our stretcher to wherever the patient is, transfer them to ours, and then load them. So we have two options, but this way is typically the quickest, and those EMS yellow stretchers work beautifully on grass, much better than ours. So we typically like to take them this way, and they'll just lift them by the back door into the aircraft, and we can secure them on our stretcher.
Okay, and then once they're inside, I'm assuming that the treatment that you're going to do, it's going to be fairly quick. You're going to start while you're still on the ground, or do you have to lift off before you can start working on the patient?
We're going to try not to do nothing that's going to prevent us or cause a lot of time. Especially when we're on the ground. If we can do it in the aircraft, we'll do it in the aircraft typically. If you do need to put a UT tube down or something, we like to do that on scene. It's difficult to do in the aircraft due to space. But IVs, fluids, different medications, all of those we can start in the aircraft. We have everything in there. It's like a little mini ER.
Now, is it safe all the way around the helicopter? I mean, can people walk up there and watch you take off?
No, sir. That's a huge issue for us. We typically have firefighters or other people at the scene help us secure the aircraft. We have a tail rotor guard that guards back of the tail rotor of the aircraft, which is the most dangerous area. Make sure there's no bystanders that come to the aircraft. Our pilot stays with the aircraft at all times and constantly surveying the scene and making sure we don't have people coming up onto the aircraft.
We also have Lieutenant Mark Hollinsworth with the Sheriff's Office. Lieutenant, I see that a state trooper is talking to the man that was the driver of the car. Can you tell me a little bit about what's he asking?
He's asking him such questions as, how fast were you going? Were you driving on the correct side of the roadway? Were there any factors such as, were you adjusting the radio? Were you talking on the cell phone? Things of that nature, anything that might distract the driver from being able to concentrate 100% on operating the motor vehicle correctly.
So has your office seen an increase of texting, cell phone problems from teen drivers?
Unfortunately, the answer is yes. As cell phones become more and more common in our day-to-day activities, we see a higher use of cell phones, and we've also seen an increase in texting while driving with everyone, including the teenage population. Just a reminder that it is illegal for any driver under age 18 to use a cell phone, handheld or not, while they're driving. The only exception is if it's an emergency or when the vehicle is fully parked.
Okay, and it's illegal to be texting while you're driving. It's probably as dangerous to pull over on the side of the road if you don't have ample space to text, is it not?
Absolutely. It's illegal for anyone, regardless of their age, to text or read an email or text from a cell phone while they're driving. And you have to be especially careful, find an open parking lot, somewhere with plenty of room to pull off safely to the side of the highway, because drivers don't pay attention and they can run off the road and strike your vehicle just as easily as if you were standing on the side of the road.
Okay, talk about patients or the passengers in a car that distract the driver. Maybe the driver's not texting or not talking on the cell phone, but what about the passengers inside the car? Maybe even in the back seat, if they're texting or screaming or shouting or whatever. What about them?
Passengers can be a larger distraction than anything. When you have multiple people in a vehicle, the folks can be talking, singing, yelling, screaming, whatever the case may be. and it may distract the driver and cause them to turn around for a split second. And that split second can mean the difference between them staying where they're supposed to be or crossing the center line and striking another vehicle head on. Teenagers should know that their first year of driving, only one non-family member under the age of 18 is allowed in the car. After their first year of driving, no more than three non-family members under the age of 18 are allowed in the car. And Virginia does have a curfew law which prohibits a driver under age 18 from driving from midnight to 4 a.m.
So there's a maximum number of passengers that you can have in a car?
Yes. Again, it was one non-family member under age 18 is allowed in the car the first year of driving. And then after that first year, no more than three non-family members under age 18 are allowed.
Wow, they had three or four passengers in this other car.
Absolutely. There's definitely probably a passenger restriction violation in that vehicle.
Okay, how can law enforcement help educate and encourage to deter teens from not buckling up? I know that one of the patients here, the young lady who was killed, was thrown through the windshield and didn't have a seatbelt on. How do you work on that? How do you improve that?
Through community outreach and educational programs such as YOBASO, and this demonstration is key point to getting people to be aware that safety belts do save lives, and it can keep you from being thrown from the vehicle, which is a major factor in someone being killed in a motor vehicle crash.
Okay, as you can see, the trooper is talking to the driver of the car. He's giving him certain field sobriety tests. He's asking to count for him. He's asking him to follow the ink pen. This is to determine that he is either drunk or under the influence of drugs. Lieutenant Hollingsworth, how do you make that final determination from this point? Does he go to jail if he fails?
Based upon the field sobriety test that the trooper is giving him, the determination we made that he feels there's enough reasonable suspicion and probable cause there to make an arrest for operating under the influence, he'll do so. And the standardized field sobriety test, along with the ink pen, which is called the horizontal gaze nystagmus, can tell an officer within a certain point or two of what the DAC is if it's alcohol related, and it also can detect narcotics use such as marijuana or prescription medication.
Darlene, what are they doing over here to this patient next to the trucks? They're pushing on her chest.
It looks like she has gone into cardiac arrest and they are starting CPR.
Okay, and CPR is, what does that do?
They are actually pumping the heart for her at this time, and they will put her on a back valve mask, and they will start breathing for her.
Okay, Laura, why would that patient not be changed and go into the helicopter?
If he was still on the ground, he probably could not take both, because CPR requires multiple people. And if we did have another aircraft on the way, that would be a perfect candidate for to go by air. So if the crew maintained and they were still doing CPR and our second aircraft landed, by all means, that thing would occur, but right back, you go back to the aircraft and get started from there.
So you can do CPR in a helicopter?
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, we do it quite often. So You can. It's not ideal, but we'll do whatever we need to do.
I don't know if you've been watching all the activity that's going on around the cars. The patients have been taken out of the cars. They've been put in the ambulance. As you see, the one ambulance speeding away now to go to the hospital, and I'm assuming that they would probably go to New River Hospital, maybe Montgomery Regional if they've got all these victims. But now, as the trooper continues to talk to the young man driving the car, what else could he be doing now, Mark?
He is gathering evidence for this crash investigation. The case that he is building against the driver could be anything from operating under the influence DUI. It could be operating under the influence of drugs, DUID. It could also be manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter, such as those things, due to the fact that there is obviously one fatality involved in this motor vehicle crash.
Now, if this young man goes to jail, is he going to have to stay in jail until he goes to court?
He will not. He will be allowed.
Oh, man, they're putting the cuffs on him now.
The trooper has determined that obviously he was operating under the influence and has placed him under arrest for DUI or DUID. What most folks don't realize is that even prescription medication affects your ability and slows down your reaction times, and we've seen a dramatic increase in arrests for operating under the influence of prescription medication as well as illegal narcotics.
Okay, now as the trooper takes the young man off, I'm assuming he's headed on his way now to go to the jail, or does he go to the hospital, or what does he do?
Depending upon the charge, if it's alcohol related, he will take the driver to the intoxilizer room to get a true reading of his alcohol impairment, which will give a certified copy that will be used as evidence in his prosecution. If he believes that there are narcotics involved, he can take the driver to the hospital and have a blood draw done, and that blood is also used to produce evidence in prosecution for that.
Okay, and Chief Saul, I see that, I'm assuming now the firemen have pretty much finished their job. They're sort of, I guess, putting everything back on the truck, and is their job done now?
Well, for right now, Neil, they'll probably, like the deputy said, they'll have a scene recreation come in and do a recreation of the accident. The fire department's just getting the road back open and make the pathway open so they can get through.
Okay, and Lieutenant Collinsworth, what is a crash reconstruction team? I heard you say that was our... Chief Saul said that was something that would be done now. What does that mean?
Crash reconstruction is basically, in its comparison, if there was a homicide scene, a investigation would be conducted for that. Crash reconstruction is a team of folks who are certified in crash reconstruction, and we come in, we look at the scene, we take all factors into consideration, we measure skid marks if there's skid marks. If the vehicles are new enough, which most vehicles now are equipped with a quote-unquote black box, much like an aircraft, and we can download that information, find out how fast they were going, whether or not they were wearing safety belts, and can track that back to quite a bit of time prior to the crash actually happening.
Okay, so then why reconstruct the crash? I mean, it's happened, you see the cars here, everybody's been taking pictures, the fire department, the rescue squad, police are here. Why reconstruct it? It's sort of like living it all over again, isn't it?
It is, and what we try to do is we try to paint a picture. For the whoever's investigating the crash, we want to have all the causative factors, which would help in the prosecution of any type of manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter charge. Basically, what we're doing is using mathematics and physics to recreate up to the event of the crash and determine. In this particular case, we still have a driver who is alive, and that is a plus. Generally, we don't have a driver when we reconstruct a motor vehicle crash. In those events, no matter what the circumstances, we interview all the passengers and find out things like, was the driver texting? Were they turning the radio? Were they looking in the back seat? What type of distraction it might have been that caused them to initially start the motor vehicle crash?
I know that when you reconstruct it, you take all these measurements, and you said that mathematics and physics, you're trying to, and I think you probably said it the best, you're trying to paint a picture of exactly what happened prior to and at the moment of the crash. And that allows you to determine more of a cause. Why did this happen?
Yes, and by using the measurements, we can determine if the driver says he thinks he was going 50 miles an hour, we can measure the distance of his skid marks, and we can throw it into an equation, and we can figure out with that factor, along with the weight of the vehicle and the coefficient of friction of the pavement, we can determine within a plus or minus range of about 2 miles per hour what the actual speed was upon impact.
Wow, that's close. As you see right now, lifeguard Laura, y'all have it taken off. This is a simulated event. You would probably already be in Roanoke and the patient probably in the operating room.
That's exactly right. Usually if we come down and come land on a scene like this, our helicopter will be what we call stay hot. We will not shut down. We will stay running. Our crew will go to the patient, we'll load them while the aircraft is still running and lift. So yes, we'd be in Roanoke by now. Hopefully that patient would be getting all the care they needed in the trauma bay.
Pretty interesting. Now, I see that Horn Funeral Home has pulled up on scene, and the patient who was killed in this crash has been moved over. I'm assuming that very shortly she would be moved into that hearse and taken off. What if that individual wasn't dead? What if they had made a mistake? How does that happen? I see all the paramedics and all these people, they're checking and checking and checking. I guess it's just one of those things that they have to keep working on to make sure that this person truly didn't have an opportunity at life. Now, I see on the other end, a couple of troopers are talking to a lady there. I'm assuming at this point that they have notified this individual of a death in her family. That's typically done by law enforcement, Lieutenant. What do you say to a family member when they've lost a loved one?
In that event, you try to console the family member as much as possible. You have to be professional, but you also have to have a caring side as well. And it's the worst part of any law enforcement officer's job is to have to notify a parent that their child has been killed in a motor vehicle crash. You try to help them understand as much as they possibly can, but you don't want to give them all the details until you have completed your investigation. As you can see in this scene, this is very true to task. A lot of parents show up on the scene because news does travel fast. If someone's driving by and sees a car, someone picks up a cell phone and calls a mom or dad and tells them, hey, we saw your son or daughter's car involved in a crash.
Now, why wouldn't they let her see her daughter?
the main reason is that I try to explain to parents is the condition that the person is in right now, that's not how you want to remember that person. You want to remember the good times. You want to remember them at their best. And being removed from a motor vehicle that has been crashed, whether they're bloodied up, whether they're bruised, whether they have been dismembered, you do not want a parent to be able to remember their child, the last memory that they have, as seeing that child in that condition.
I understand. Now, she just keeps trying, and looks like she's pretty confident she's going to get there sooner or later. Would they arrest her?
Not in this situation, unless she became to the point. The easiest thing you can do is try to get her seated into a car, get her relaxed, provide her with water, and comfort her as much as possible, because she has breathing, and the first part of it is this panic stage and the disbelief that this has happened to them and to their child.
Okay, and then at what point in time do the rescue members, the fire department members, law enforcement, decide that it's time for the funeral home to go ahead and take the body?
Once we receive notification from the medical examiner and confirmation that it is okay to remove the body from the scene, we do so. And upon the arrival of the funeral home, we do remove the deceased body from the scene so that the public doesn't have to see that body continue to lay there, whether it be on the side of the road or not.
Now, would this individual be taken straight to the funeral home, or do they have to go somewhere else? They have to, or what happens after that?
In this particular crash, this was a passenger. Their body would probably be taken first to the funeral home. If the investigating officer wished for an autopsy to be done upon that person, then the funeral home would transport that body to the medical examiner's office. If it was the driver of the vehicle, normally they would go straight to the medical examiner's office, because we want to know such things as whether they were impaired or not, or under the influence of some type of narcotics or alcohol.
Chief Saul, a lot of your members are now at the patient. Are they there basically to assist in the funeral home in loading that patient, or are they there to protect the patient? Why are they still there?
Yeah, they're basically there out of respect to the patient and the parents. We try to do what we can once we've got the scene cleaned up. We'll try to help out any way we can with the coroner and help them load the body.
To all the students, I know that a lot's gone on in front of you. I do appreciate those of you who have paid attention, and wish that those of you who haven't would see the seriousness of this this demonstration. Each year during this time, between prom and the end of the school year, we typically respond to these type accidents. Not just on those times of the year alone, but throughout the year. And while this is a drama, this is something that we've done to try to give you an idea of just how things work. It is a serious event. You have classmates that you've spent your entire 12 years with that could be in this very same situation. And the seriousness of what we've done here today is not to be diluted by your talking and so on and so forth. It's to impact to you the seriousness that that we face out here every day. And as you become drivers, as you become passengers in vehicles, so often we have the events that happen that. We would love to turn back the clock and change the circumstances. But really and truly, folks, that just doesn't happen. As you see what's going on now, the fire department is assisting the funeral home director in placing the individual in a body bag. What that does is basically seal that body for transportation, and then they would either be taken to the funeral home or to the medical examiner's office, and where further examination of the body would be done. As soon as the individual is loaded into the funeral car, then they'll be on their way to wherever it might be. Again, as you can see, the mother of this patient is extremely upset. She's quite a handful for two individuals because of her emotions. She's very upset over what's happened. And I would just ask, you know, think about what your parents would go through in the event that this happened to you. So as the hearse is being loaded, the patient has been taken from the scene. This was the last good time that Kimberly will be exposed to in her high school career and also in her life. So I ask you for this moment, if you would focus on the funeral car, please stop your conversations and pay attention as the funeral director leaves the scene of the crash with Kimberly on her final ride.
As the hearse drives away, turn and look at your neighbor to your left. Then turn and look at your neighbor to your right. Today is Wednesday. Think about if on Friday you turn to your left or right and that person is no longer with you. There's lots of smiles here. This is not a time to be smiling. This is a somber occasion. Because it could be that person riding off in that hearse. Folks, I'll ask once again that your attention be placed on the funeral car. We have just a couple of more minutes and we will complete the event here. I would again like to thank those of you who have taken this very seriously and understood our intent here is not to bring trauma to you, but to hopefully prevent a real life event such as this from happening. These things are very true. They happen each and every day. And we would just ask that you, when you get in a car, whether you're the passenger, the driver, maybe it's somebody that you just walk to the car and turn around and leave, that you would do so with all the importance, all the safety that you possibly can. And please remember, this is not a slogan. Drinking and driving does not mix. Drugs and alcohol are not a place behind the wheel. So we ask for you to strongly pay attention to what this has meant today.
don't be a distraction and don't be distracted as you drive and you occupy the highways in our community and throughout the world. I call on Sherry now for the conclusion.
Thank you guys for your participation, cooperation as we watch Shattered Dreams. We want to thank all the volunteer fire, rescue, police, lifeguard, sheriff's department, state police, quarantine service, and especially the Yoga Show Club for bringing these presentations to you. We hope you drive safe, buckle up, slow down, drive sober. This will conclude Shattered Dreams. Thank you.